A verse in the scripture says, even if the black mountain were ink, the ocean an inkpot, a branch of the wish-fulfilling tree a pen, the earth a writing leaf, and if using all of these the goddess of learning would write for eternity, the limit of your virtues would not be reached. History has borne witness to great and extraordinary beings. Luminous, all-knowing, poised in perfect wisdom, they go through life in a blaze of light and ecstasy, touching lives and transforming them, compassionate and wise. Gautam Buddha was one such. This is his story. The story of the Buddha is a pageantry of wisdom and compassion. There is agreement about the basic elements of the life of the Buddha amongst the scriptures of the different schools of Buddhism and historians. But inevitably, elements of the life are interwoven with the supernatural and the mystical and legend and myth. These are as much a testament to the faith of the storytellers as they are to the literary traditions of that time. The parents of the future Buddha were rulers of the modest Sakya tribe, living in the principality of Kapilavastu in what is modern-day southern Nepal. One night, Queen Mahamaya, in a dream, saw a white elephant penetrate her right side. She became pregnant in an immaculate conception. 10 lunar months later, en route to visiting her parents, leaving King Suddhodana behind, here in these Lumbini gardens, in a curtained enclosure, she grasped the branch of a tree and gave birth to Prince Siddharth, one who aspires to success and prosperity. It was 563 BC, the month of Vaishakh in May.
Legends are replete with the story of the Buddha's birth. The heavens and earth waited in hushed anticipation as the hour drew near. The gods themselves seemed to come out to witness the event. A magical calm descended on the wild beasts of the forest. It is said that the child started walking as soon as he was born, and strewn lotus blossoms bloomed under his feet at every step. What awe and wonder it must have been for a mother to know that she had carried such a child in her womb and created him from her own flesh and blood. One day his fame would spread like a bushfire from the lofty Himalayas to Cape Comorin, go beyond the frontiers of Ceylon, Burma, Siam, Malaya, Java, Sumatra, and onto Nepal, Tibet, Mongolia, Korea, China, and Japan. His teachings would become a world religion and a great cultural force in Asia. In our century, it would reach out again to the Western world. Aryasuri, in his Jataka tales, recounts 34 previous lives of the Buddha as a peacock, a king, a buffalo, all times when he suffered the pain of birth and death, but remained calm, courageous, and pure in every life. In this life, unmindful of his future greatness, Siddharth grew up to be a strapping young prince, handsome to behold. An astrologer in King Suddhodana's court had said, your son will either be a Chakravartin, a great emperor, or a great saint. The king's preferences were clear. He would leave no room for chance. The prince was surrounded with the pure, the beautiful, and all that seemed eternal. Anything that might suggest impermanence and sadness was banished from the cloistered enclaves of Siddhartha's palace. His wife, Yashodhara's exquisite beauty, was talked about in distant lands. Legend has it that even dead flowers were kept out of his sight. Yet, King Suddhodana could not thwart destiny for long.
Opinion is divided on the precise location of the historical Kapilavastu. There are contending claims from Nepal and here in India. What we have here are the ruins of a 7th century monastery believed to have been built at the site of Kapilavastu. In Kapilavastu, the young prince Siddharth stood to inherit the material world. He could have everything that he desired. The palace symbolized that physical world, yet one that was fleeting and would end at death. The first phase of his life is marked by youthful indulgences, perhaps the privilege of innocent immaturity. When Siddharth confronted the pain and the suffering of old age, sickness and death, he was made to realize the impermanence of all that he valued and cherished above all else. At the age of 29, in keeping with a widely practiced tradition, he became an itinerant seeker.
The city that Prince Siddharth left behind was described in a traditional account as one shining with the splendor of gems. Darkness, like poverty, could find no place here. Prosperity shone resplendently, as with a smile, from the joy of dwelling with such surpassingly excellent citizens. There the sun, even though it had retired, was unable to scorn the moon-like faces of its women, which put the lotuses to shame, as if from the excess of passion, hurried towards the western ocean to enter the cooling water. Prince Siddharth was gone. Only the beginnings of a Buddha remained. As he left the precincts of the palace, spurning the worldly fetters of man, it seemed as if the entire kingdom had been lulled into a mysterious slumber. His faithful charioteer, Chenna, caught up with him at the edge of the forest, and bathing his feet with tears, stopped him from leaving. The Buddha picked up the distraught charioteer and, with eyes brimming with incredible compassion, gently said, "Chenna, I am doing this for everybody." Prince Siddharth headed towards Rajgir, the capital of Magh, modern-day Bihar. He lived then in troubled climes. Warring kingdoms disputed territories, while hidebound Brahmanical traditions exploited the rest of society. Philosophers and ascetics were dry and impoverished, expounding either gloomy doctrines of self-mortification or senseless gratification of the senses. Amidst all this, Siddharth roamed through Magh, looking for a teacher who would answer the questions that troubled him. Why do we suffer? Why are we born? Why do we cling to the objects of this world? How do we dispel Mara, the prince of evil? Despairing, dissatisfied with the contemporary teachers he studied with, he moved to the Urivella forests, performing austerities beyond the pale of human endurance. They say that the world trembled with the weight of his penance. He wavered precariously at the brink of death. Six years he spent by the banks of the Niranja River, emaciated, relentlessly punishing his mind and body in the hope that the vaults of knowledge would be opened and the secret of human existence revealed to him. His efforts were in vain. Even a faint glimmer of the great truth eluded him. They say that the strains of a singing ferryman broke him from his reverie. The lyrics of the music moved him. It said, if you pull the string of the instrument too hard, it will break. And if you leave it too loose, it won't play.
Calm, yet restless, yielding and yet grasping in some ineffable way for the ultimate truth, Shakyamuni decided to break his long fast and the long, arduous years of asceticism. He bathed in the river, and a beautiful village maiden, Sujata, came by and offered him a gruel made of rice in boiled milk. Sujata might well have reminded Shakyamuni of his beautiful wife, Yashodhara, and the pleasures of the senses that he had left behind in the palace. Once again, he thought, this was the temptation of the mythical Mara. He redoubled his efforts and soon attained equanimity and mindfulness.
In the words of Sir Edwin Arnold, but the Buddha heeded not. Sitting serene with perfect virtue walled, as is a stronghold by its gates and ramps. Also the sacred tree, amid that tumult, stirred not, but each leaf glistened as still as when moonlit eaves, no zephyr spills the gathering gems of dew. For all this clamor raged outside the shade, spread by those cloistered stems. As he sat in meditation, fighting the angels of evil and their many-pronged lances of doubt, passion, and desire, it is believed that the king of serpents, or the mythological Sheshnaga, tenderly shaded the Buddha under his hood. It was as if all of nature was waiting with bated breath for that moment when he would grasp the essential truth and lead mankind out of darkness. In the Jataka, it is said, he turned his back to the trunk of the Bodhi tree and faced east. Let my skin and bones and sinews become dry. Let all the flesh and blood in my body dry up. but never from this seat will I stir until I have attained the supreme and absolute wisdom. He sat himself down in an unconquerable position, from which not even the descent of 100,000 thunderbolts at once could have dislodged him. The simple and practical teachings of the Buddha developed into a rich and complex religion as it evolved in different cultures and nations. But that also served a utilitarian purpose. Any successful, enduring religion must evolve to suit the psychological, social, and material imperatives of contemporary men and women. In the early centuries, ceremony and architecture inspired religious feeling and spirituality. If necessary, Buddhism would use them as vehicles to inspire the truth.
On the night of the full moon, in the month of Vaisakhi, on his 35th birthday, Shakyamuni sat in deep meditation. His mind was bright and unblemished, full and balanced. With utter concentration and deep confidence, he surrendered the watcher and entered a deep, fathomless openness, unfettered by content. A deep contentment pervaded him. With gentleness, tenderness, and utter clarity, he untied the knot of birth, old age, sickness, and death. He had become the Buddha, the enlightened one.
Prince Siddhartha was now the Buddha, no longer a seeker, but a giver of wisdom. The despair and struggle had given way to peace and confidence. But he wasn't sure if men would understand him. The great god Brahma himself descended from heaven to persuade the Buddha to preach his doctrine. For 4 weeks, he had meditated upon his newly found truth, preparing himself to become a teacher. On that full moon night when he attained self-realization, the earth was so happy that it shook like an overjoyed woman. Today, pilgrims from across the globe are drawn here. The glossy green leaves flutter like a million Buddhist prayers, each seemingly imbued with a life of its own. The Mahayana philosophy that evolved from early Buddhism was to make a distinction between the truth as the Buddha actually saw and the form in which he revealed it to most men. The Buddha had tried to make things simple for those who heard him. He explained the truth in the form his audience was most likely to understand it. He would reveal the innermost transcendent doctrines to those who could understand and appreciate when the time was ripe. The Buddha had left questions about metaphysics, the ultimate nature of things, unanswered. These questions were irrelevant to him in the quest for liberation. The pragmatic and utilitarian attitude of the Buddha was to leave a permanent mark on the character and philosophy of the religion he inspired. One of the fundamental tenets of Buddhist philosophy is the belief that the truth about a fact or thing is determined by its usefulness, by the purpose it serves. Suffering is the basic condition of man, the Buddha reasoned. Was there a way to end that suffering? He believed he had found a solution. Peace and tranquility could be gained by the extinction of desire. He laid forth the rules of behavior that could lead to that extinction. Sarnath remains a hallowed place for all Buddhists. It was host to an event deeply embedded in time. That was when the Prince Siddharth went public as the Buddha for the first time and articulated ineffable mysteries in words. He talked about the unknown universe, of infinite possibilities, and it was here at his feet that his first followers learned how to rid themselves of the baggage of the material world and discover themselves.
The Buddha, out of a commitment to sharing the insights that he had gained from his enlightenment, traveled to here, what is modern-day Sarnath. The journey which today takes 4 hours by train must have taken him some 10 hours walking. He decided to come here, seeking the 5 ascetics he had left behind, thinking perhaps that they would be the most receptive. After some initial skepticism, he was able to teach them the first turning of the wheel of dharma, the 4 noble truths. The first noble truth is the fact of suffering, that happiness is ephemeral and transient. In the second noble truth, the Buddha taught the causes of suffering, our clinging, grasping minds. In the third noble truth, the Buddha taught that enlightenment, nirvana, was possible. To the path that he taught in the fourth noble truth.
Sarnath emerged as a major pilgrimage center in the centuries succeeding the Buddha. The landscape is fairly flat, dotted with beautiful trees and with monuments that poke out abruptly from the green groomed earth. The Dhammik stupa stands majestic and serene, a grand memorial of an invaluable treasure. From the foundation of ancient mysteries lying in the grass, pilgrims have erected walls and buildings, and the rustling of trees in the summer winds seem like the whispering of ancient voices speaking of the middle way, the 4 noble truths, and the 8-fold path. The early shrines were preserved for centuries. Monks and scholars from China and Japan traveled to India to visit them. One of the best known of these is Huyen Sang, who came to India when Harshavardhan was king in the mid-7th century. He reported that at that time there were 1,500 priests in the convent who studied the little vehicle. It was the twilight of Buddhism in India. Soon the great Buddhist shrines would fall to the destruction of invaders.
Thank you.
as a site associated with the major events of his life, it was second in importance only to Bodh Gaya. The veneration of his relics became a central feature of Buddhist life in the centuries after his death. As his teachings traversed the globe, pilgrimage centers arose, focused on their worship. Kings and commoners tried to emulate the example of the later emperor, Ashok, who raised great monuments to honor the Buddha's relics and commemorate his life. The Buddha said to himself, "In Varanasi, in the deer park, will I turn the wheel of the law. Seated in the fourth posture, O deities, I will deliver the world." "Pleasant is Vaishali," the Buddha had said to his aide, Ananda. "Pleasant are its shrines and gardens." Those years are associated not only with a number of stories, but also with the last years of the Buddha's life and the announcement of his approaching death. Calling himself a worn-out old cart, he had said, "Ananda, this is the last time that the Buddha will look upon Vaishali." As he left, he looked longingly at the city one last time, embracing fully its beauty. Once a flourishing city on the banks of the river Ganges and celebrated in literature, little of the old Vaishali remains. Yet its excavated mounds offer themselves to the traveler's imagination. As if sitting beside the bhikkhus, one can almost hear the teachings of the Buddha. It was the fifth year after the Enlightenment. The Buddha was here at Vaishali when he was informed of the impending death of his father. The Buddha appeared immediately before him, flying through the air, and gave him a last teaching. King Suddhodana thus became the first lay person to attain the perfect state of being. Buddhism has ever emphasized filial responsibility. The Buddha was to be tested again soon. His foster mother, Queen Mahamaya, came to Vaishali and asked to be admitted to the order. The Buddha refused. Traditional Brahmanism had opposed the ordination of women, and the Buddha didn't want to upset his contemporaries. When he was reminded of the devotion of his foster mother, the Buddha relented. And so Queen Mahamaya became the first Buddhist nun. But nuns were subjected to a far greater discipline and retained under the authority of the monks. Vaishali was also the venue of another famous conversion to Buddhism. Amrapali, the famous dancer, invited the Buddha and the monks to lunch and then gifted them her mango groves. 200 years later, the great emperor Ashok convened a Buddhist council here. He built an Ashok pillar and stupas at the sites associated with the life of the Buddha to spread his message and his edicts. The message that the once warrior emperor Ashok, repelled by the violence he perpetuated himself, now proclaimed to the world, transformed the ancient Indian ideal of the universal emperor. He would conquer the world to the power of truth Dharma Vijay. The Ashoka pillar stands alone, sentinel to the splendor of Aishali that once was. Reminiscent of a time of religious and intellectual freedom, unparalleled in human history. The lion at the head of the pillar, or Sugata Singh and its symbolic roar of the proclamation of Dharma, the right way.
The Buddha was in his 36th year. During the 45 years of the Buddha's teachings, he required a mountainous labor of patience and care, not to mention an incalculable amount of walking. The seeker had found the truth. Disciples flocked to him and grew in numbers. The Buddha taught in the middle Gangetic basin. Each morning, he and his disciples went out to beg for food and practiced during the afternoons and evenings. In the rainy season, both laypersons and monks alike received teachings at retreats, which soon grew into big monasteries, as here at Shravasti.
The monsoon season was a difficult time to travel in India. The monasteries that were to develop out of the rain retreats of the Buddha and his followers became the nucleus of Buddhist religious life. They became responsible for the spiritual care of the community. Emperor Ashok had encouraged the growth of the Buddhist Sangha into a strong religious organization. In time, the Sangha would emerge as a potential challenger to state authority. It became a powerful moral force, opposing despotism and tyranny. Shravasti was listed by Ananda, the chief disciple of the Buddha, as the first of the six great cities of India. It emerged as one of the major centers of Buddhist monastic life. Its ruins, even today, are reminders of the degree of civilization that had been attained in the Indo-Gangetic basin more than 2,000 years ago. The period of inaction that the monsoons imposed upon the monks allowed them to devote their time to scholarly pursuits and the contemplation of metaphysical problems, which the Buddha had discouraged in his own time. These were later to become centers of philosophical activity, as well as theological dispute. Universities like Nalanda and Taxila soon arose from the rain retreats or viharas. The institution of monastic life allowed each initiate the opportunity to experience the struggle that Siddharth himself must have gone through. The worship of the Buddha as God soon became the prevalent religion in many countries of the world, not something the simple monk would have approved. The monastery preserved the original emphasis on the simplicity and humanity of the Buddha. It constantly acted as an agent of reform. A desire to return to the original teachings of the Buddha was kept alive in the heart of these centers of austerity and learning. The monastic brotherhood provided a continuity in experience and tradition down the ages, unaffected to a large extent by external vicissitudes. And as the traveler continues to Rajgir, once the capital of the North Indian kingdom of Magh, ruled by King Bimbisara, the Rajgir hills leap out to greet him through the landscape draped with low smoke wreaths. The ropeway raises him high above the surrounding landscape, offering a pleasant contrast between the grit of the ground level and the loneliness of the skies. It is believed that when the Buddha entered the gates of the city, the citizens were so awed with his splendid serenity and incandescent grace that they fell over one another to catch a glimpse of the beautiful beggar on their crowded streets. Hearing rumors about him, the king Bimbisara went out to greet him, and struck by his words and his brilliance, as he sat resplendent on the green mattress, he hastily alit from his chariot and prostrated at the Buddha's feet. Later, the Buddha was to witness this loyal patron suffer imprisonment at the hands of his own successor and son, Ajatasatru, and survive 2 assassination attempts on him. Desire and ambition, the Buddha taught, are like a fire that is ever thirsty. It was this fire of imperial ambition that would soon consume numerous kingdoms and destroy its people as they fell before the victorious armies of the Mauryas. It would burn through the kingdom of Kalinga before King Ashoka repented and atoned before the world.
The Buddha visited Rajgir several times. The first while he was still an ascetic. He was seen by King Bimbisara, who noticed an exceptional quality about the Buddha. He made him promise that he would return after he'd found the truth. And return the Buddha did. Soon after the first turning of the wheel of Dharma at Sarnath, the Buddha with 1,000 monks and followers arrived at Rajgir. He was greeted by King Bimbisara, who gifted him a mango grove, which was to become the first property of the order. That first year was also significant because it marked the conversion of the 2 principal disciples of the Buddha, Shariputra and Meghlayana. But Rajgir is perhaps best known for this, the Vulture Peak, for it was here that 15 years later, the Buddha gave the 2nd turning of the wheel of Dharma. He taught to a group of 500 monks, nuns and laity of shunyata, emptiness of inherent existence, of dependent co-arising. The Buddha gave different sets of teachings intended for people of different mental dispositions and proclivities so that the doctrine was easily accessible and could lead to a quick transformation.
Today, in the twilight zone of a gentler reality, a higher road takes the visitor to the commanding heights of the Vulture Peak. Its slopes dotted with monuments, the mountain continues to offer visitors the age-old invitation to meditate and escape from the world, as the Buddha himself had done several centuries ago. Time and again, the Buddha would return to Rajgir. He preferred to spend his time at Vulture's Peak. It was here that he gave many of his sermons, including the principal Mahayana or Greater Vehicle Sutras, which he delivered before a select audience of elder disciples and enlightened beings. Looking down from the peak, his disciples may well have sensed the possibility of victory over the lusts and strife of the earthly realm below. All these pleasures of the world confront us with emptiness. Just like illusions, they burn up like a great fire.
In his 79th year, the Buddha set out on his last journey. Knowing the end was near, he continued with his teachings. "I'm a tired old man," he exhorted his followers. "Rely on yourselves. Validate your experience. Take refuge in the teachings." In keeping with the tradition of advanced meditation practitioners even today, the Buddha chose the time and place of his death. He told his disciples that he would leave his body in 3 months at Kushinagar. There was consternation. Why had the Buddha chosen not to extend his life and continue with the teachings? And why Kushinagar, a relatively unimportant place at that time? The Buddha assured them that Kushinagar was indeed sacred. In ancient times, in a previous incarnation, when he was the universal monarch, it had been his capital. The Buddha arrived in Kushinagar, lay down between two sal trees, his head pointing north and face looking west, a position from which he would never arise. He continued teaching his disciples till he was able to ask 3 times if they had any questions or any doubts. He told them, "All conditioned beings are perishable. Take refuge in the teachings. Pursue your realizations." He then left his body after going into deep meditation and completing its cycles.
Like all conditioned things, the Buddha is no more. 2,500 years after his death, his life still embodies the highest human aspiration for millions. Most visitors, still trapped in samsara, feel an incomparable sadness at the foot of a giant statue of the reclining Buddha, lying in eternal repose, radiating an ineffable bliss. It was here that Ananda, weeping and inconsolable, had not wanted his teacher to die in the miserable provincial nowhere that was Kushinagar. Exhorting him, the Buddha had said, "Be an island unto yourself. Take refuge in the Dharma." From pure compassion, he who had already won freedom from bondage to the karmic wheel, tendered his body. An unceasing flow of seekers come, wanting to establish a bond with the Buddha. Catch a glimpse of him through the ruins, touch him through stories and symbols of great places of pilgrimage. Through the odysseys to the places of the Buddha's life, They search for an understanding of his words. Long have you wondered and filled the graveyards full. Between his ancient wisdom and the harsh realities of life, they look for that transformatory moment of realization that can only come from the grace of a true master. The Buddha had withheld the most difficult and profound doctrines of the Dharma for fear they might be misunderstood. It was only after his immediate disciples had begun to develop right understanding and an awareness of the underlying principles that he began to impart the most fundamental truths of all. Nirvana was not annihilation, but a blissful state of subtle mind, a state incomprehensible to the limited faculties of the ordinary mind and indescribable in mundane terms. It could not be spoken of. It could only be experienced. For many years after his death, scholars and seekers of truth congregated in Nalanda, perhaps the first university in recorded history to evolve deeper insights into his teachings. It grew to be a great center of philosophical and secular learning. Many different traditions flourished, each profound in their intellectual sophistication. More than 1,000 years later, during the reign of the last Buddhist emperor, Harshavardhan, Huinsang, the famous Chinese itinerant, visited Nalanda and was deeply impressed by the thriving Buddhist traditions of Tantra, logic, and dialectic. Centuries later, like the transience of all conditioned things, Nalanda lies in ruins, its art and architecture crumbling. Yet travelers and seekers are drawn to the empty corridors of its denuded buildings to behold the silent Buddha in stone and remember that our world too is subject to the law of birth and decay, and so shall also pass.
The death of a great human being marks not an end, but the beginning of an era. In particular, when that life has been led pursuing eternal principles of universal truth and out of compassion for humanity in the service of mankind. Today, 2,500 years later, we are still inspired by the life and the teachings of the Buddha.
Wander forth for the good of all, said the Buddha. As millions quietly go about their lives, they are inspired and enriched by a truth, a human being, not a god, discovered at the foot of a peepal tree.
Thank you.